Hey everyone, the first part of our final look into Disney films may be uncomfortable since the first portion will look into Walt Disney's most controversial film. Before that, however, Joe and I hope you've all enjoyed what you've been seeing so far. It's been a while since we did a trilogy, and we just want to say thank you for sticking with us. As with every video, if you enjoy it, please be sure to like, share, and subscribe. Also, to help us put out more content, please support us on Patreon. Now, without further ado, I'm Big Rob, and here's a look into Disney's live-action films. Enjoy. As we covered in Part 1, Walt Disney in 1921 made Alice's Adventures in Wonderland, which combined live-action and animation. He would continue this trend when he started making feature-length cartoons. Saludos Amigos and The Three Caballeros were two of his earliest successes. However, in 1946, Walt would release a film that to this day has never been released on home media, Song of the South. Song of the South is one film both Joe and I have been uncomfortable with talking about. But since it's a part of cinema history, we have a responsibility not to ignore it. To better understand the controversy behind this film, we need to look at the man who the stories the film is based on, Joel Chandler Harris. Joel Chandler Harris was an American writer who gained success through his stories, Uncle Remus, His Song, and His Sayings. He took inspiration from the novel Uncle Tom's Cabin, which was written by Harriet Beecher Stowe, who was both an author and abolitionist. Stowe's novel depicted the harsh reality of what life was like for African American slaves, which brought together anti-slave forces in the North and angering those in the South. Joel Chandler Harris, who was pro-slavery and even worked as an apprentice on a plantation, called Stowe's novel a wonderful defense of slavery. His Uncle Remus stories presents his title character as a freed slave who tells a variety of stories in what was known as Deep South Negro dialect. At the time of its publication, Harris's stories were widely praised. This revisionist portrayal of slavery and the relationship between Southern whites and blacks was instrumental in how black people would be negatively portrayed for over a century. In 1938, Walt Disney became interested in Harris's Uncle Remus stories, and in 1939, wanted to produce a purely animated film, but later decided to combine it with live action. Southern-born writer Dalton Raymond was hired to be one of the screenwriters. Raymond presented his outline to the Hays office, and they demanded that he remove references to Uncle Remus as, and I quote, "old darky." African-American writer Clarence Muse was hired by Disney to consult on the script, but soon quit when Raymond refused Muse's request to portray the African-American characters with dignity as opposed to Southern stereotypes. These issues would only be the first of the film's problems. Jewish writer Maurice Rapp was soon brought in to help with the script, and was initially hesitant about doing the job because he knew the film would be Uncle Tomish. Walt Disney responded to Rapp's concerns by saying, and I quote, "That's exactly why I want you to work on it, because I know that you don't think I should make the movie. You're against Uncle Tomism, and you're a radical," unquote. Maurice Rapp would also leave the film due to a personal dispute with Dalton Raymond. When the film was released in 1946, Song of the South became a box office success. The film was also nominated for two Academy Awards, Best Scoring of a Musical Picture and Best Original Song. It won the latter award for the song, Zippity Doodah. James Baskett, who portrayed Uncle Remus in Song of the South, won an honorary Academy Award for his performance. As expected, there was a lot of controversy over the film's portrayal of African Americans. I think the best way to describe the controversy is to read a quote from Walter Francis White, the executive secretary of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, or NAACP. He said, and I quote, "The National Association for the Advancement of Colored People recognizes in Song of the South remarkable artistic merit in the music and in the combination of living actors and the cartoon technique. It regrets, however, that in an effort neither to offend audiences in the North or South, the production helped to perpetuate a dangerously glorified picture of slavery. Making use of the beautiful Uncle Remus folklore, Song of the South, unfortunately, gives the impression of an idyllic master-slave relationship, which is a distortion of the facts," unquote. Song of the South was re-released in theaters several times throughout the years, most recently in 1986.
How'd you like to make friends with a very unusual rabbit?
How do you do?
Meet a crazy fox or a bungling bear. Introducing Uncle Remus, Brer Rabbit, Brer Fox, and Brer Bear in the happiest, slappiest, dashingest, crashingest, singingest, flingingest Disney animated classic of all. This holiday season, Walt Disney's Song of the South is back on the big screen. Rated G. Now playing at a theater near you. Check your local newspaper.
Even as the United States had made great strides in equal rights, the film still earned $17 million at the box office, making it a box office success again. Amazingly, the film has been rebroadcast on various European and Asian television networks as recently as 2006. Even the BBC has rebroadcasted it. I do want to point out a few more things before we move on. The first and most obvious is that you won't find this film on DVD. The Disney Company has refused all requests to release the film on DVD, even for educational purposes. Secondly, there were African American critics that viewed the film favorably. For example, Herman Hill, who was USC's first black basketball player and later became a civil rights activist and journalist, wrote in the Pittsburgh Courier the film could, and I quote, "prove of inestimable goodwill in the furthering of interracial relations," unquote, and labeled criticisms of the film as unadulterated hogwash symptomatic of the unfortunate racial neurosis that seems to be gripping so many of our humorless brethren these days. Third, Walt Disney himself felt uneasy during production. However, Joe and I have to wonder, if Walt Disney felt uneasy about the source material, why bother making the film at all? Fourth, the theme park ride Splash Mountain, which is a log flume based in Disneyland, Magic Kingdom in Disney World, and Tokyo Disneyland, is based on the film. While there are some variations to the ride story-wise, the ride is still operating to this day. Finally, the cast of Song of the South all stood by the film. Hattie McDaniel, who became the first African-American star to win an Oscar when she won for Gone with the Wind, was cast as Aunt Tempe in Song of the South. She said in 1947, and I quote, "If I had for one moment considered any part of the picture degrading or harmful to my people, I would not have appeared therein," unquote. James Baskett will say, and I quote, "I believe that certain groups are doing my race more harm in seeking to create dissension than can ever possibly come out of the Song of the South," unquote. Before we go on to our next topic, Joe and I want everyone to first take a deep breath. The first part of the video was hard for us to cover given the material, but as I said before, we had a responsibility to cover it. As the old saying goes, those who do not learn history are doomed to repeat it. To help transition to our next topic, here is the trailer for the film Treasure Island.
Disney, whose
artistry marked a new era in motion picture entertainment, now sets a new milestone with his first all-live action feature, Treasure Island. The story which thrilled 200 million readers throughout the world. Only Walt Disney could bring to realistic life and with such dramatic impact Robert Louis Stevenson's memorable characters. Long John Silver, portrayed by that world-famous star, Robert Newton.
We can take this ship right now.
Then I say cut their throats. And I say there'll be no killing till I give the word. Shipmates.
Shipmates.
Bobby Driscoll, the 1949 Academy Award winner for his outstanding performances in The Window and So Dear to My Heart, plays Jim Hawkins, the boy who faced a thousand dangers.
One more step, Mr. Hands, and I'll blow your brains out.
Yes, they're all here. Pompous Squire Trelawney, Captain Smollett, Dr. Livesey, the murderous Black Dog, rum-swigging Billy Bones, the villainous Blind Pew, and poor Ben Gunn, marooned on Treasure Island.
Treasure Island was Disney's first completely live-action film. Released in 1950, the fifth film adaptation of the classic novel by Robert Louis Stevenson was not only a box office success, but critics also praised it. Robert Newton, who played Long John Silver in Treasure Island, would reprise his role twice. The first reprisal came in 1954, when Newton played the character in the film Long John Silver. This was also the first CinemaScope movie to be shot in Australia. Newton's second reprisal of the character was in the television series The Adventures of Long John Silver, which premiered following the film in 1954. The 1950s saw a bit of a transition from mostly animated films to mostly live-action films. For example, Disney made The Story of Robin Hood and His Merry Men, The Sword and the Rose, Rob Roy, and 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea was adapted from Jules Verne's novel of the same name, and was another critical and commercial success. The scene that is best remembered is of the fight with a giant squid, something that helped the film win the Academy Award for Best Visual Effects. The film also earned the Oscar for Best Art Direction. Actor James Mason is also remembered for his fantastic portrayal of Captain Nemo. In fact, we'd like to show you one of his best scenes. Enjoy.
I can hardly believe it. How one could conceive and build such a craft, and in a single stroke harness power beyond the wildest dreams of science. Why, such a secret could revolutionize the world.
Or destroy it.
See how peaceful it is here. The sea is everything. An immense reservoir of nature where I roam at will.
With seeming indifference, Captain Nemo held the key to the future of the world. As I studied him, I became aware that powerful forces were at work within this strange man.
Think of it. On the surface, there is hunger and fear. Men still exercise unjust laws. They fight and tear one another to pieces. A mere few feet beneath the waves, their reign ceases, their evil grounds. Here on the ocean floor is the only independence.
Here I am free. Imagine what would happen if they controlled machines such as this submarine boat. Far better, but they think there's a monster and hunt me with harpoons.
Going into the 1960s, there were even fewer animated films being made, as Walt Disney had focused nearly all of his attention on live-action films. As we discussed in the last video, Disney animated films were questioned by studio employees as to whether they had a place anymore. As for live-action, the last one I want to look at is The Happiest Millionaire. This was the last film that had personal involvement from Walt Disney himself, before his death in 1966. The Happiest Millionaire was based on the true story of millionaire Anthony J. Drexel Biddle. Biddle's daughter, Cordelia, had written a book about her father called My Philadelphia Father, which was made into a play. Walt Disney acquired the rights to the play in the early 1960s, and at first did not intend for it to become a musical. However, looking over other live-action musicals of the time such as Mary Poppins, My Fair Lady, and The Sound of Music, Disney greenlit the idea when the film's original producer Bill Walsh suggested it. Unfortunately, Walt Disney would die during production on December 15, 1966. Had he lived on through the making of the film, he may have prevented the film from being edited down to such a large extent. What began as an original 172-minute runtime was edited down to 164 minutes for its Los Angeles premiere, then down to 144 minutes for its New York City premiere at Radio City Music Hall. Finally, The Happiest Millionaire was edited down further to 118 minutes for its general release. I believe these constant cutdowns contributed to the film not making a profit. While the music and cast were praised, the film was considered a box office disappointment. That being said, Joe and I want to show you all a scene from The Happiest Millionaire. It's a nice short musical number. Enjoy.
Now, if a girl wants to be popular nowadays, there's one thing that she absolutely needs to know.
What?
Ba-yum-pum-pum. 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 Ba-yum. You must be oh-so mysterioso. Enthusiasm is très passé. You must slink across the floor. A dreadful bore to the rhythm of bayam pum pum bayam pum pum bayam pum pum bayam. I need to know they feed a barrel, hollow cheeks and black mascara.
Bayam pum pum bayam.
Okay, what's next?
The men in college always acknowledge a girl who dances in a trance. So by up until the dawn, as if you're about to yawn, to the rhythm of
by up pum pum by up pum pum
attitude chord
by up pum pum by
today. The key to being wanted is just to glide as if you're haunted.
as you secretly conceal the tingly way you feel when you're dancing to Bayum Pum Pum, Bayum Pum Pum, Bayum Pum Pum, Bayum.
Way home. Good night.
We hope you enjoyed this final look into the amazing world of Walt Disney. While we only scratched the surface of this man's history, what we did show should be enough for everyone watching this to enjoy their favorite Disney films and to look up others they may not have seen. If you liked the video, please be sure to like, share, and subscribe. Also, please become a member of our Patreon page to help support what we do. The links to the show's social media pages are in the description box below. Please stay safe and healthy, and we'll see you again soon.
Why?
Because we like you!
Goodbye, everybody!
We really love you!
Be careful getting home!
Bye-bye!